So that's why we are having this is 1 over epsilon naught to the force. And then we come to the sixth question. And the sixth question is that the very first thing is that why it is pi? Pi involvement is there, and what's the reason for this one? And then why don't we have 2 pi but we have 4 pi? We know about them individually, that what do they mean? They are having specific meanings. Like pi is the ratio of the circumference L to the diameter. We know this thing because the circumference is 2 pi r and the d is 2 r and it is equal to pi. If I'm having a certain length and that length I just combine the ends of that one, then it will make a circle, and inside that circle it will have its own diameter. So the ratio of the circumference, mean that length, to the diameter will be equal to pi. It means it is from linear dynamics to rotational dynamics, or from translational dynamics to rotational dynamics. We know about 2 pi as well. When this pi becomes 2 times, then it is a complete rotation. Like complete rotation, periodic motion, complete rotation will be 2 pi. And then when this 2 pi is multiplied with another 2, then it becomes 4 pi. And 4 pi, we know that this is not the planar angle, but this is the three-dimensional angle, which we call is solid angle. Solid angle, which is a three-dimensional angle, and this thing we denote by omega, the capital omega or big omega, and this is equal to 4 pi. This is, for example, I'm looking to the board, and then the board, it's in two dimensions, so I'm seeing only a planar angle. But when I'm looking to any 3D object, for example, let's say I'm looking to a sphere, then I'm not seeing only the plane area of the sphere, but also its curvature, being looking in 3D. So the angle is supposed to be 3D, like a cone, in order to cover that round area viewing as well. So when we consider the point charges, point is a sphere, and when one point charge is seeing the other point charge, then it is seeing it is round. And that's the reason when we will be covering this thing in Gauss's law, we will come very clearly to the point that yes, this is actually due to the spherical nature of the charges. So this is the three-dimensional angle which is involved there. And for that reason, we are having 4 pi here. And the last question that we are going to address is the non-statics. Like when we do calculate the radius of hydrogen atom, are the electron in the first orbit in and how much radius it is going, then we use the Coulombic potential. The Coulombic potential is based on the Coulombic force. So the Coulombic force and the centripetal force we compare, and from that we derive the radius of hydrogen atom, and that radius comes out to be 0.529 angstrom. That radius comes out to be. And when Bohr calculated this one, then miraculously this thing is very accurate. although the calculations are not good for the other orbits, but for the principal orbit, which we call the S orbit, which we call the completely spherical orbit, the calculations are very right. Then the question comes in mind that as we were considering this thing for the static charges, the Coulomb law was for static charges, then why it is giving us a good result for the moving charges? When we consider the electron which is going around the, let's say this is a proton, and the electron is just going around it. This is completely spherical orbit, the S orbit, and this is the electron which is here. Now this electron is going around it. It's a moving charge. Although there is some oscillations in this one, we neglect that one, but this one is a moving charge. Then why we are applying this thing to the, and applying this one first, and then why it is giving the very accurate result? So the very first thing I told you in the beginning, that the source charge is supposed to be stationary, while the test charge, like here, this one to be stationary, this one may or may not be stationary. So one reason is this one, that due to these reasons it is giving us the right result. But there is another insightful thing in this one, that if we look from the point of view of proton, then what the proton is seeing, how the protons come to know that electron is going around me, and that we know that there is a field which is the electromagnetic field, and the particles, the virtual photons which are exchanged between them, are actually the particles which are the mutual particles exchanged between them, which we call the virtual photons. They are constantly exchanged. We call them virtual due to the reason that it is not like that this proton is emitting this photon, and it is reaching here and it is receiving it, and after receiving it then releases it again and it reaches the proton. It is not like this. These are virtual. These are called the mediating particles. Now we know that the speed of electron in this orbit, the speed of electron in this orbit is very, very less than c. While these photons, these mediating particles, are being exchanged at equal to c, at speed of light. So what the proton sees, when we know, when this flashing between the two is more quick than the movement of this one, then the proton will never see this electron in motion, but the proton will always see this thing only changing its position, and it is not moving at all. And as the distance is constant, so that's why it gives us the right result. This is like, for example, let's say that this chart is falling from this bow, this position to the bottom. And this motion that we are observing, let's say it's a dark room and we are having a flashlight. We are having a flash so that we are switching it off and on. If the flashing will be faster than the speed with which it is going down, then we will never see this chalk in motion, but we will only see that it is just changing position. And might be, you know, that in some of the FSC books there is stroboscopic image. So stroboscopic image is taking the image very quickly. So this will not, the proton will never see the electron in motion, and that's the reason that the result that we obtained is right. The result that we obtained is right for spherical orbit only. There may be some other questions in your mind, so you may pose them. I will try to include them in the explanation. Okay, now this was a very generalized discussion on this one, on the Coulomb's law. Now we go to the Griffiths and we will follow the notations there, and I will tell you that what does it mean. Let's say we are having a coordinate system, and a coordinate system is such that it's a three-dimensional, and we will consider in these three-dimensional the planar one. We are having, let's say this is x-axis, this is y-axis, and this one is z-axis. This is plane, and this z-axis is just perpendicular to this one. And now let's say we are having a source charge, and the source charge is here. This is the position where we are having the source charge. And as I told you, we will have to represent this one with small q. And we are having a test charge here. And this test charge we will denote by capital Q. The distance between the test charge and the source charge we consider is tilted R. This R is this distance. And this is the origin. And the source charge is having distance R prime, means R prime. We will denote the charge, the source charge, with prime coordinates. And then the distance from the origin to the, this is this distance, and the distance from the origin to the test charge is simply R here. So R prime and R here, and this is from the origin to the source charge, to the test charge, and this point we also call is point P, which is the observation point. Now in this situation, I will write the law, the Coulomb's law is the law which is this one. So it will tell me that force F from the origin on this test charge, so it is at point R, means the force at the observation point at R is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, means the value of K, and then Q1 is our one charge, Q2 is our another charge. So I will call the Q1 is the source charge Q, and the test charge is Q, capital Q, divided by the distance between these charges. The distance between these charges is tilted R, so it will become R square. And as I have made this thing is a vector, so this will be in that direction. So it will be tilted R from here. From here I can write that R prime plus this tilted R is equal, means this vector plus this vector is equal to this vector R. And further, I can write the tilted R here is equal to R minus R prime. Now, I can write that one, that F of R, 8 point P, the force is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught and Q over R square. So it will be R minus R prime. And square of it, and this will be an R minus R prime and unit vector here. So R minus R prime unit vector here, or I can write this one is a vector, like R minus R prime is a vector. I will not write this one, and this I will make is cube. So this way I can write it in this form. Now, for example, we move the source charge at origin, like moving this one at origin now. So what will happen? The R prime will come out to be zero. R prime will be equal to zero then, and tilted R will be equal to R. So I can write that F of R will be then equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, and further Q divide by R squared in R unit vector. So it means that the thing we have written here in this one, we have already assumed that the source charge is at the origin. When the source charge will not be at the origin, then our expression will be like this one. Another thing that we usually encounter in Coulomb's law, that if, for example, we are having this charge is Q1 and this charge is Q2. Now, this one is Q1 is exerting a force of this one. This is a repulsive force because both are positive charges. It's a repulsive force, and this force is equal. This is equal to the force on charge 2 due to charge 1 is F21, and similarly, this Q2 will be exerting a force on this one, and this is equal to F, and this is the force on charge 1 due to charge 2. And we know from here that F12 is equal to the minus of F21. They are in opposite direction. They are repulsive forces. They are equal in magnitude, like it's a mutual force. F12 is the same as F21, and they are in opposite direction. And that's one kind of representation of action and reaction forces. From this one, then in the next part of the lecture, we will go to the electric field. So for Coulomb's law, I hope this is sufficient discussion. And in the next lecture, we will go to section 2.1.3, which is the electric field.